Hey, Tim Berglund here at the end of the summit. And this talk is positioned at a place where we'd normally put closing thoughts, but I got to thinking these really aren't closing thoughts. This isn't the end of the summit. This is the beginning of the next stage of your work with Kafka. And you know, stages are really what I want to talk about. Kafka is growing in important ways. It's kind of growing into its next stage of life. I think we're growing with it. And I really think you saw that on display here at Summit 2020. And you know, development is a universal phenomenon. It happens to people as they grow from babies into adults. Now, here is my colleague Grace with her little boy, Bennett. Bennett is super cute. And here is a picture of him when he was newborn just a few months ago. And his mom is doing what you do with newborn babies. There's a lot of things you do with newborn babies, of course. But one of the things is you just kind of hold them and cuddle them. And sometimes they sleep and sometimes they cry and sometimes they're happy and you kind of tickle them and touch them. And that's what you do. And you sort of know when you pick up a baby, that's how you love that little baby. It's kind of automatic. That's appropriate for that stage of that baby's development. Now, when Bennett's older, of course, hopefully he'll still always get a hug from his mom, but that's not how she's going to be his mom anymore. There'll be all kinds of different things as that child grows through different stages of development that you do to be his parent. And the same sort of developmental stages, they happen in friendships. They happen in marriages. Now, my wife and I just visited our middle daughter who got married a few months ago. And they're very much newlyweds, and it's just adorable, and it's wonderful to see. And being a newlywed is not the same as being married for 30 years. One is not better than the other. But the thing is that there are all these developmental stages that you go through, and that things develop over time. It happens to organizations. Now, I've been working for startups for a lot of the past 10 years. And in my observation, there are a few defined inflection points. Say there's like from the start to about 75 employees. And you get past 75 employees and people start to say, oh, it's different. You know, the initial people are like, wow, it's such a different company. We're so formal now. And then you get to kind of 250 people and some of the old timers leave, right? The folks who were there at the beginning, they don't want to be there anymore because it's not the kind of company anymore that they want to work for. They want to go find something new and exciting and another A-round startup to join. And then, you know, that kind of lasts for a while and there's this slow change. And it feels to me like around 800 employees, there's another inflection point, another developmental stage is reached. Now, mind you, this is just me saying this. I don't have any business scholarship to back up these numbers. It's kind of my observations. But I think I'm onto something. I think you have three totally different companies in there in the life of that startup. There is development in the organization, and the development passes through stages. And remember, people are the same way. A toddler can listen to Baby Shark on repeat for literally hours and eat only mac and cheese three times a day. I think with amino acid supplements, you'd have to do something to some protein problems in there. But you know, the parents raising that toddler are gonna kind of want a different diet and more diverse entertainment choices if it's possible for them to get them. They're not gonna wanna be that toddler because they're just at a different developmental stage. Think of Kafka when it was new. If you remember Jay's keynote this morning, he was talking about that because he was there. Baby Kafka, toddler Kafka, didn't even have replication. I mean, can you imagine that now, relying on distributed data infrastructure without replication? I mean, it just doesn't seem normal. And it was very much, Kafka was very much born in a world that knew what the cloud was. I was around in 2010. We did talk about the cloud then. But there was nothing really cloud native about Kafka in its origin and in its architecture. The assumptions that drove toddler Kafka were the existence of a data center that you could go to. Maybe like you go and there's the biometric hand scanner, and you, boop, you go in, the door opens and there's loud fans and it's cold and your skin gets dry and there's these racked sheet metal boxes with real computers in them and blinky lights and everything. It's a neat world, but that's really not the stage that the rest of us are living in now. And that was the stage that early Kafka grew up in and the worldview assumptions that it had. And you know, those were good days. Being a toddler is great, but then you start to grow up, you develop new capabilities and you develop new needs. And the things that met your needs when you just ate mac and cheese or Tyson chicken patties three times a day, or however it was that you got down when you were little, that doesn't cut it anymore. I actually don't know what I ate when I was a toddler. I have no idea. I assume it was a relatively normal little kid diet. But here's me at age 13. And I think I probably had a more sophisticated palate, a little bit, not you know, I probably wasn't going for like the kale and the balsamic vinegar and the super spicy foods or anything like that. And I certainly, let's be honest, wasn't really a very snappy dresser yet. That stuff didn't come online yet. But, you know, hey, I wrote code. This is me on my dad's Vicar 9000 actually writing code, which is a different later stage of development and a new capability that comes online. And because of that new developmental stage, not only can you do new things, but you kind of need new things around you. And you've heard at Kafka Summit in sessions and in keynotes about that process of growing up, that happening to Kafka itself. You had Anna Povsner talking in her talk about sharing is caring, that's self-tuning and multi-tenant Kafka. In 2012, there wasn't self-tuning Kafka. Like, I know some of the people who tuned it. It was their job. This wasn't a thing that computers did. They did it. And it wasn't multi-tenant, you know, you were LinkedIn. It was the thing that you had. These are indicators of a much more sophisticated ecosystem and a more sophisticated set of needs that the people in the community have. Simon Aubrey of ThoughtWorks talking about running KSQL DB in the wild. What KSQL DB? That's this whole other thing, runs outside of Kafka. It's a SQL layer for doing real-time stream processing on Kafka. And here Simon is teaching you how to do it. And a funny thing about SQL is, you know, it was invented and it became ubiquitous very quickly. And every once in a while, we like try to create a new kind of data infrastructure abstraction that we think is going to meet our needs better. And like, we don't need SQL for that. But it happens like as this coming of age thing, you're going to build a SQL, like build a key value store and have that key value store become ubiquitous and have lots and lots of people use it, even if it's not ubiquitous, just super popular. And a SQL layer will emerge for it. Like I could give you examples of that really happening in the real world. SQL, the existence of a SQL for Kafka is itself evidence of a developmental milestone being reached. Grace and Kate of IBM talking about reactive application architectures. Now, again, think, if you were around, think of Kafka in 2014. People still said Hadoop then. Kafka was this big pipe that you could get things and put them into HDFS real fast. And that's a very simple application architecture. And, you know, sure enough, in the early days, that had its own challenges and people delivered value by doing that. I'm not trying to mock it. I'm just saying, if you didn't watch Grace and Kate's talk, go back and watch it and look at the kind of intellectual sophistication that's present in the community now that you hear from them talking about application architectures based on Kafka. And these legitimately are the right kinds of application architectures that sort of ought to emerge from a set of event streaming assumptions. And they're here now. They weren't here before. This again is a sign of maturity. And of course you heard Gwen talk about KIP 405, tiered storage, KIP 500, zookeeper removal, and all its associated sort of vassal KIPs. Did you listen to the customers? I can't ask you to raise your hands because we're not in the room together, but I would. Did you listen to them? You had Citigroup, you had Lowe's, you had Newly, Expedia Group. And if you listened to them, you heard them and just kind of like get up to 30,000 feet and ask yourself what they said. They were talking about the same things I always say when people ask me why Kafka is important. What did they say? Let me sum it up. They said microservices. They said real-time analytics. They said a lot of other things besides that. I'm not going to reduce all of their wonderful interviews to 10 seconds. But summed up, they were hitting the classical Kafka tropes, the good old use cases everybody trots out when they want to give examples of why to use Kafka. The thing is, they're real. These people who are big time users of Kafka in meaningful ways, they're doing these things. And this kind of solution tends to draw Kafka into the center of an enterprise, just like you heard them talking about. And once you're at the center of the business, once Kafka is there and it's like all the money that you can put on the table is moving through Kafka or substantial parts of it, the Kafka of yesterday doesn't cut it anymore. The fruit snacks and the 600th viewing of Frozen that used to be so satisfactory to the toddler, that's not what we do anymore. Now those give way to a nice restaurant and maybe you got tickets to Hamilton. Or imagine back you know, when you could go places. Now you can drink wine in your living room and watch it on streaming. But you know, those dates and those nice adult experiences that you thought of that are different from what a toddler engages, you know, this is an adult's idea of a good time. Likewise, real-life Kafka use cases are growing up. You heard it here. I mean, the actual discussions from these real users reflect adult use cases. The Kafka that used to be deployed on boxes that you bought and managed in your own data center has to become something else to live in the cloud and operate across locations, across data centers, across availability zones, across regions. It has to change. And that's what you're seeing. That's the Kafka you're seeing, a Kafka that's reaching its next stage of maturity, a Kafka that is entirely, if I may use this rather imprecise term, entirely cloud native. And we don't have a rigorous definition of what that means, but you know it when you see it, right? And certain of these things, like storage constraints being removed, KIP 405, scalability limitations being greatly pushed back, that's KIP 500 and its and all the gang that are going along with it. The ubiquity of Kafka. You can run Kafka in whatever major cloud provider you want these days using a fully managed service. It's pretty incredible. You don't have to be racking boxes. You don't even have to be installing software yourself. This is now a piece of data infrastructure that looks the way the current world expects data infrastructure to look. And this is what the Kafka community demands. This is what you demand, because this is how maturity is defined now. And this is what the community is building. I think Jay showed you this slide earlier. I love it so much, I had to show it to you again. Because folks, this is you. Have you been to a Kafka meetup? Well, you're one of the people there. Did you ask a question on Stack Overflow? Well, then, you know, you're represented in that number. Are you on the mailing list? Have you commented on a KIP? This is not them. This is not a abstract community thing that's somewhere out there that, you know, we speak platitudes about and say that we like. This is you, and this is me. And the systems that you're building with Kafka are the ones that are demanding this next level of maturity. And I know this because I talk to you, I meet with you, my colleagues work with you. And, you know, you come to events like this to learn, right? To get inspired, to get new ideas, to disconnect from your normal routine, to try to get a sense of what you're gonna do next and what you should be thinking of next. And to kind of quote that old saw, where the puck is going, so you can skate to where the puck is going to go to. That's a big reason people go to events like this. And I know online shows are a little bit different. Believe me, I know. And maybe you've been able to disconnect, and maybe you haven't. I hope you have. We all disconnect different ways, different places. I mean, I watch videos while I cook. I mean, I recently watched a 2-hour React tutorial over several meals. There's 20,000 people here. Somebody was cutting vegetables during some of this content, I'm sure of it. And tweet me if you did. I would love to hear if that was you. But you know what, however you do it, I hope you've been able to detach from your normal life a little bit and see things. I hope you've seen a Kafka that has already been a tremendous global success on a, you know, close to unprecedented scale for projects like this. And one that's not just parked there, but really is ready to go to the next level and is going to that next stage of its development. It's ready to follow where we're leading, to build the things that we're building and the demands of our businesses, the things that our businesses are pushing us to build. I hope you've seen a Kafka that has left its previous developmental stage and is entering the next one with vigor. So, like I said at the beginning, this is not the end of anything. This is the beginning. The beginning of the next stage of your work with Kafka. And thinking about it in this way, I wonder a year from now, where are we going to be then? That is up to no one but us.